What food made you think, how the frick did our ancestors found out this was edible? The fruit of the gympie-gympie plant. It is also known as the suicide plant because its sting is so painful that there have been reports of people and animals killing themselves to escape the pain, which can last for days or even years. The sting is delivered by tiny hairs that cover the whole plant. Yet someone was able to discover that if you painstakingly remove each hair from the fruit, it is edible. Someone wasted their fucking time. What the hell else was there to do? Coconuts. Greater than a plant common to rainforest areas in the northeast of Australia, fucking course it is. The cassava. However, cassava is poisonous unless it is peeled and thoroughly cooked. If it is eaten raw or prepared incorrectly, one of its chemical constituents will be attacked by digestive enzymes and give off a deadly poison cyanide. As little as 2 cassava roots can contain a fatal dose. 2 cassavas can feed a small family for life. Same with the cashew. How many people had to die before we had our delicious curved nut snack? Read that as nut sack. Some mushrooms that require special preparation. Eat it raw or cook it like most other shrooms and you end up dead. Boil it 3 to 5 times, however, and it's fine. Edit. An example of a mushroom requiring this procedure is Gyromitra esculenta. Also, my most upvoted comment is now about mushrooms. Also, rip my inbox. Okay, so boiling it once didn't work, and boiling it twice didn't work. But what if, and just hear me out, we tried boiling it a third time? Well, I would protest, but entertainment doesn't exist yet. Fuck it, third time's the charm, monsieur. Lyfish, or lutefisk, don't get me wrong, I love the stuff, but man, first you go get a fish, then you let it hang on a stick for months to dry out, then you put it in water for a couple days, then you put it in water with lye for another couple days, then you put it in pure water again, and then you cook it and eat it. Cashews. First, they come from a drupe that grows out of a false fruit called the cashew apple. So right off the bat, you'd never to guess that it would be the part you'd eat. Cashew apples look kind of like a cross between an apple and a red bell pepper. Just with a big, ugly dark brownish cashew in place of a steamy sour. Second, the shells of cashew drupes contain a substance that causes rashes and chemical burns on skin. So before you can even think of eating a cashew seed, which is what cashew nuts actually are, it has to go through a multi-step steaming and roasting process just to totally burn off all the irritants. Wait, but I buy raw cashews all the time. Are they actually not raw then? Maybe they're unroasted? But yeah, if they're not giving you mouth rashes, then they're extensively processed somehow. Joke's on you. When I eat cashews, my mouth gets all scratchy and rashy, and my throat closes up. It happened yesterday. It may be because I'm allergic though. I dunno for sure. Edit. Thanks for all of the comments down below wondering about my mental state. I've known I'm allergic to cashews since I was a toddler, when I ate some trail mix. Yesterday's reaction was a shitty coincidence, with a half-cut banana laying next to some cookies with cashews to blame. It sucked a ton. So thank you again for all of the condolences. Puffer fish. Only a small part of the fish is edible and the rest is deadly poisonous. So how did they find out which bit was edible? Trial and error. I guess having 14 kids had some purpose to it after all. Just have 2 kids, one called trial and the other called error. Once you realize how rare food really is in the wild for every 365 days, it makes a lot more sense. Starvation and famine was a regular event for most of human history. Lose your own stash of food for a couple days and you'll eat all sorts of things. I can't remember the exact quote, but in some Michael Pollan documentary or book, he says something to the effect that sugar, salt and fat occur extremely rarely in nature. So our bodies are programmed to want as much of those things as we can get. In our modern world where you have pretty much instant access to all of those things. Boom. Obesity epidemic. Not gonna lie, I could really go for some salty, sugared fat strips right now. Maple bacon it is. Bread. Like, how did someone put all the ingredients together to make the bread? I think about it all the time. Yeah, there must have been a lot of trial and error involved, but you can see the thought process. They must have gone, look, there's all this grass, like literally freaking everywhere. We're hungry, and there no food about. So what if we took the grass, mash it up with water and stuff, then cook that? Single quote. Bread, as far as I have understood, basically started as being paste made of just poorly crushed grain and water. Later someone decided to heat it up. After that people started figuring out all the other stuff you add to bread nowadays. Finally my science fair paper pays off. Someone in ancient Egypt probably left porridge out in the sun, and yeast got into it. It became bread. Then they experimented and figured out how to reproduce it, except fluffier and yummier. The first flatbread was from much earlier. People would leave primitive dough on rocks in Jordan and they'd cook in the sun. Bread. Edit. For anyone wondering my source, I learned about this on a Netflix's Cooked Air documentary. Thanks everyone who pointed out my lack of evidence. Oysters. Someone looked at that snotty looking thing from a shell and thought, yeah, I'm gonna put that in my mouth. Monsieur looks just like jellified gray sneezing matter from inside a seashell. Bound to taste salty. Duo on it goes. Erg, get me some lemon. Wait, what's a lemon? Poke salad. The pokeberry pokeweed plant that grows in the southern U.S. has edible leaves. Sort of. If you eat them raw, they contain a neurotoxin that will make you extremely sick or more likely kill you. If you cook them, the toxin will still kill you. If you boil them, the toxin will still kill you. So basically someone died after eating this stuff and their friends went, well, maybe if we boil it one more time, died, and someone else went, third time's the charm. Quote. However, if you boil them, discard the water, boil again, discard the water, then boil one last time and discard the water again, the leftover cooked plant is sort of edible. To add to the fun, you also have to pick the right part of it. You need to pick the young shoots before they have any red in the stems, or the boiling just won't cut it. Hickarl. Usually poisonous. Unless prepared thus, the traditional method it is by gutting and beheading a Greenlander sleeper shark and placing it in a shallow hole dug in gravelly sand, with the now clean cavity resting on a small mound of sand. The shark is then covered with sand and gravel, and stones are placed on top of the sand in order to press the shark. In this way the fluids are pressed out of the body. The shark ferments in this fashion for 6 to 12 weeks depending on the season. Following this curing period, the shark is then cut into strips and hung to dry for several months. During this drying period, a brown crust will develop, which is removed prior to cutting the shark into small pieces and serving. Ooh, I've tried this. It's not even that good. It tastes like blue cheese but moodier and fishier. It also tastes and smells like ammonia, coming from the fact that a shark's bladder closes up when it dies. It's not even that good. It's a fermented shark corpse. What did you expect? This seems like way too much effort for fish fingers. Acorns. How hungry one must be to figure out to pound them to powder and leach out the tannins. Three times. Came here to say that. At Yosemite, I saw a demonstration of how the locals leached acorns. The process is days long, with many, many steps. Also, how the hell did Stone Age man discover nixtamalization of corn? If you don't do it, and you rely on corn as a primary food, you get a nasty deficiency disease, pellagra. Here's what Wikipedia has to say on the subject of the discovery of nixtamalization. How nixtamalization was discovered is not known, but one possibility may have been through the use of hot stones to boil maize in early cultures, which did not have cooking vessels robust enough to put directly on fire or coals. In limestone regions like those in Guatemala and southern Mexico, heated chunks of limestone would naturally be used, and experiments show that hot limestone makes the cooking water sufficiently alkaline to cause nixtamalization. Archaeological evidence supporting this possibility has been found in southern Utah, United States. Coffee. Can't eat the beans as is. Gotta roast him first, whoops. Not yet. Gotta grind him, assure him. Not quite right yet. Let's pour water over them and drink the water. Let's try using hot water. Perfect. I am so glad you asked. The legend foes that an Ethiopian goat farmer observed his goats acting energetically after eating the cherries off of a coffee tree. The original Arabica plant. He tried it and the caffeine took effect. At first it was eaten. I don't recall if they cooked the beans first or just ate them straight from the cherry. Over time, as we do, we experimented. IIRC they were medicinal for a time. Before it was coffee as we know it today. The roasted, ground beans were consumed with the hot water used to make it coffee, and to this day some still drink it that way as Turkish coffee. We learned how to separate the grounds from the water and eventually how to create a stronger coffee drink using pressure. Espresso. Wish I could remember when and where the very first coffee house and coffee cart came into existence, but IIRC. It's not where one might assume. Edit. Oh shoot. Thank you for the silver. And thank you to the pros for correcting and expanding on the post. Hold up just one hot second there, buddy. They're coffee cherries? Think of it like this, my friend. A coffee bean isn't actually a bean, like black or red beans. It's actually a seed from inside of a fruit. We just call it a bean because it's shaped similar. So just like cherries, the coffee tree grows a fruit that has a seed inside of it. We take that seed, strip the flesh around it, and roast that bitch. You know the rest. Now I ask, have you heard of cashew apples? Greater than cashew apples. Mate, you can't do this to me at this time of night. I won't sleep. What the hell is happening on this planet and why don't I know anything about any of it? You should know about Fremunda cheese. Yogurt and cheese. It's like first of all they start drinking cow juice from cow titties. Then they save some for later. It goes off. Voila cheese. Not even just that, cheese needs rennet from an animal's stomach to turn into cheese. They were storing milk or curds or something in a nasty ass improperly cured goat stomach or something and then decided to eat it when it turned solid. Chili peppers. Like imagine finding this pepper, taking a bite, and then feeling your entire mouth feel like it is on fire. Then you decide it's actually really good though and start including it into dishes to add spice. Scrolled way too far down to find this. Consider that hot peppers fail every single edibility test. It irritates the skin, mouth, and bowels. By any survival guide's methods, you should not eat this thing. But we ate that shit anyway. Probably on a dare. Yeah, I've always heard that that's one of the ways our ancestors used to figure out if unfamiliar plants were edible. If you tasted a tiny bit and it was horribly bitter or made your mouth tingle or burn, you'd spit it out and assume it was poisonous. So who thought it was a good idea to keep eating chili peppers? What if we added just a little bit to one of these usually bland foods we eat? It should all balance out. Dish elevated. Not exactly a food, but cocaine. I saw a show going through the process of making it. All I can think is, how did someone come up with the idea of mix stuff like gasoline and battery acid together and then dry it up to powder they could sniff? How? That last part is chemistry. The fact that the raw plant has stimulant feel-good properties was known for a long, long time. Lobsters. Well, this looks horrifying. I think I'll taste it. Quote, land arthropods equals creepy and disgusting. Sea arthropods equals yummy. Makes sense, right? To be fair, there's not a lot of land arthropods that reach face hugger size. I've heard that tarantula tastes surprisingly like crab. I am not brave enough to verify that Clymosaur. Castoramosaur, a sweet tasting exudation that comes from gland near a beaver's asshole. Damn, this beaver ass smells great. Wonder what it tastes like. quote. Well, that one's pretty easy to guess. Native Americans or perhaps European fur trappers cooked and ate different parts of the beaver. Though one day, one of them happened to get this weird sweet taste and started experimenting by eating different bits one at a time until they pinpointed the location. Bada bing, bada boom, bit of a big beaver butt bite. Thank you so much for watching and have a good day.